Now, how are you guys doing? Now, Hall H, come on. We have seen from the amazing Star Trek Discovery, yes? We have seen a little bit of Lower Decks. This is gonna be amazing. But we have something here today. Someone, John Luke is in the house. I think for a lot of people, I think this is fair to say, I think for a lot of people, the idea that Sir Patrick Stewart would return to this iconic role of his was, after Nemesis, we never thought it was gonna happen. He had this other little thing with mutants and stuff, you might have heard of it. But looks like we were wrong. And I'm very glad we were wrong, because I have to say there's a tremendous, Alex has mentioned it, there's 53 years, which it's embarrassingly long in some ways, but awesome in so many others, because we're old enough to know what that means. There's been a lot of Star Trek. I think you can say yes for that, yes? Yeah. And we know that things like Comic-Con wouldn't happen if there hadn't been Star Trek and the amazing visions of Gene Roddenberry, and let's give a great applause to a great creator. And over the years, there have been some amazing captains, and they have been on this stage, and everyone, and that's one of the great things about Comic-Con, the fandom allows it, everyone has a favorite, everyone has a second favorite, everyone has a tied favorite, but I have to say, if I have to name my captain, it has to be Jean-Luc Picard. And I think that it is time to start talking about Star Trek Picard. So, Comic-Con. We already have the executive producers here, but let us bring out supervising producer of Star Trek Picard, Christian Breyer. Executive producer, Akiva Goldsmith. Executive producer and showrunner, Michael Chabon. And of course, Alex is here. Let us also bring out Issa Briones, Santiago Cabrera, Michelle Hurd, Alison Peel, Harry Treadway, Evan Elgora. And now, I would like to bring out a man who has led some of the greatest armadas in Starfleet history, a man who we have seen a little bit of so far in what seems to be his latter years, and a man who is truly a knight of the realm, truly, ladies and gentlemen, Captain Admiral Jean-Luc Picard, Sir Patrick Stewart.
Thank you.
Sir Patrick, it's been too long since you've been here with our fans. We'd love to hear what you have to say about your return.
Thank you. The first thing I feel compelled to say is that we regret the absence of possibly the most important individual in this production. And no, I am not talking about Jonathan Frakes, who is in Charlotte. I think he got Charlotte and San Diego a little bit confused, and that's where he is. No, the absence that we all feel is the dog. We wanted to have him here to meet all of you, and he was very, very excited. His name, by the way, is De Niro. And he is a wonderful creature, and I hope that he's going to have an ongoing role to play in this entire series. Now, I woke up this morning, as every morning these days, it begins with script, learning lines. And I read a line in a scene that comes up on Monday where I say, "We never know, do we, when our last moment will be." For me, I can twist that a little and say, we never know, do we, when our best moment will be. And that is now.
But you're saying you want to rewrite.
Oh no, Michael, you better leave the stage and start rewriting it.
Yeah, I'm already getting notes.
A couple of novels under your belt, now you know what it's really like, right? Exactly. My first question, and guys, we're going to take questions from you later on, and you better have some damn good ones because you've got some damn good people on the stage. I will only ask you this when we do take questions from you. One first question per person, and please direct who your question is for. Thank you very much. And my first question of Comic-Con 2019, the Star Trek extravaganza for Picard, is to Sir Patrick Stewart. Sir Patrick, you took the stage, you and Alex took the stage in Vegas almost a year ago. You shocked everyone by your return, which we all welcomed with open hearts. Why did you decide that now was the time to take on the mantle of Jean-Luc again?
Well, I decided that just over a year ago. And I had been for a long time saying no, thank you, but no, thank you, but no. And then as the subject matter of this new proposed series became clearer and clearer to me, and when I began to meet our incredibly distinguished writing team and to attend the sessions with them, I knew that something very unusual was going to happen, and I wanted to be a part of it. To imagine that something like this might go ahead and I wouldn't be there would have been just too defeatist, and so here I am. And very, very happy to be here.
And we are happy to have you. I think you guys can applaud a little louder than that. Alex, I wanted to get, and actually this is a question for Kirsten, Heather, and you. Give us a sense of how Picard is different in tone from what we've seen so far the first two seasons of Discovery.
It's entirely different. It all started with Patrick, actually, because when we went to him, as he said, he was reticent for all the right reasons, mostly because he did not want to repeat what he had already done, which he had done perfectly. So why do that again? And we had several conversations with him, and he really challenged us. He challenged us beautifully. And it forced us to think outside the box, and yet it also forced us to say, what is important about the box as it existed for people who love Next Gen? And what is it about this great captain that everybody loves so much? And Kirsten and Michael and Akiva and Patrick and James Duff and all of us sat down and we asked lots of questions about what Trek meant to each of us and what Trek meant to Patrick. And from that, these really interesting storylines began to emerge about Picard. And Picard is at a point, for sure, where he is questioning, I would say, many of the choices that he's made, and yet also he's very certain about many of the choices that he's made. And I think it's allowed us to shake the character up in ways that give you new things to play, while also honoring and respecting everything that has already been done so well.
Kirsten, you know, obviously Sir Patrick comes with his legacy of the movies and of Next Generation. What does that bring for you, bringing into the writer's room, having, I guess, the source of the source there?
Well, there's the entire universe to sort of take into account when you're building these stories and understanding how any choice you make is going to ripple out, right? But the great thing about taking this part of Patrick's story forward is by dealing with a different time in his life and really the life of any starship captain or lead character that we've ever seen before, it's an extraordinary opportunity to see just the most unknown, unexperienced part of his journey at this point. Yeah.
Heather, it looks like you have something to say about that.
Sure. I think having Patrick there from the beginning too, I mean, obviously we all watch the show and we have our opinion of what was happening in the show, but Patrick obviously had lived it from the inside out. And I think for him to bring his perspective into obviously what would Jean-Luc do or not do, or what would he like to see as an evolution of this character. And I knew that was invaluable. And also I think not only did he not want to do what he had done on TNG, we and he did not want to do what we've done on Discovery. I think we feel like the world we've painted there is very specific and it's unique to that, and hopefully everyone's going to watch and read Kirsten and Akiva and Michael and Alex is writing and feel this is its whole own, I think more lyrical, more grounded, more dramatic at times piece than that, and I think respect it for its own thing.
Michael, as some of you don't know, Michael is a Pulitzer Prize-winning author, I might add. Again, I say, come on. Michael, for you, how has the transition been? Because, of course, you're the showrunner of this, which is a highly anticipated show, and CBS All Access, all of us are really waiting for it. How has that been for you? We're just going to talk a little therapy right now.
Well, there's been, I mean, I think the answer that comes most immediately to mind is there's been so much writing. And, you know.
Well, that's kind of the gig, pal. Right?
Exactly. I don't think I've been writing professionally since I was in my early 20s. I've written a lot of books. But the Enterprise, for want of a better term, of.
Ouch.
Sorry, getting 10 episodes.
Michael, are you getting ready to engage?
I am. Yeah. Yes, I'm trying to engage. I hope this isn't a core breach about to happen, but just the having to write so much, so frequently, and in a way that's so collaborative, that involves so many writers, and not just writers too, but with our cast. And we have this, starting with Patrick. I mean, Patrick has been a collaborator with the writers from the beginning, but it didn't just stop in the early days when we were first trying to figure the show out. It didn't stop in subsequent later moments in the writer's room where Patrick came and helped us critique and review and shape the story. It's an ongoing collaboration. And I've learned to trust Patrick's judgment of the character of Jean-Luc Picard on a daily basis, on a line-by-line basis sometimes, implicitly. But that's also come true of our other cast members. And we have such, we knew that we had to have a cast that was worthy of and could stand up to an actor as incredibly gifted as Patrick Stewart. And we got that.
Yes.
This cast is unbelievable.
And let's talk about, I'm just gonna start, we're just gonna roll it. Alison, tell us a bit about your character and her relationship to Jean-Luc.
I'm a researcher. That's what I'm allowed to say. I have met, I think I can say that I've met Patrick Stewart now, right? I am allowed to say that? We can say we're...
There's video.
Yeah.
Yes.
I get to play somebody who is deeply confused as to her place in the world, who's been dreaming of something happening forever and kind of treading water for a long time waiting for it. And I think the really interesting thing about this cast as a whole is everybody here is pretty broken in terms of their character in very interesting ways and different to a lot of what we've seen. So there's just a lot of kind of lonely sad sex.
Michelle, is that an apt description for your character?
Yeah. Yeah.
All right.
I would say Rafi, first of all, is a delicious character to bring to life. Thank you. And she has a previously unrelated relationship, or part of Picard's past. And she too struggles with some demons, but don't we all? Thank you.
Nobody.
Alison in real life doesn't at all, but.
Which means they're struggling more.
100%. But I think that's one of the things that's really so exciting and delicious about working on this project is that it's so layered. There's so much to jump into and to be able to work with these people and hello. I mean, what? Am I on this panel with that man? Thank you.
Look, we'll be honest. This is a Sir Patrick Lovin. So if you're not buying in today, go, because we are here for him.
Okay?
Yes, exactly. I would tell you I shaved my head for the man, but in fact, I do it all the time. But I want to get, Evan, this is your first American role. How does it feel stepping into the world of Trek?
I mean, can you hear me? Yeah, sweet. I've watched Star Trek from such a young age, and then to be able to meet Patrick in person and then see and work with one of your idols on a daily basis, it's absolutely incredible. I wake up every day happy going to work, and I leave happy, and that's pretty much all I can say about it. Thank you for the opportunity, and it's been an absolute pleasure working with you, Patrick, and all of you, of course, but yeah, thank you. And the rest of you. Yeah.
Ouch, Evan.
Mr. Goldsman, I would like to get a sense from you. I mean, we're talking about new cast members, a new show. How do you see this? Would you compare and contrast this from Next Generation and the Picard we knew then?
Well, we pointedly wanted to not make a sequel to Next Gen. I think that tonally, it's a little bit of a hybrid. Obviously, it's, you will see, I hope, slower, more gentle, more lyrical. It is certainly more character-based. It also, you know, takes on the same thing that the original series took on, that Next Gen took on, that Discovery takes on, which is hope for a future that is in many ways better than the world we live in today. Star Trek remains aspirational, and what we get to do, which sort of DS9 got to do a little bit, and then Discovery got to do, is to tell serialized stories. And in serialized storytelling, the characters can evolve in a way that makes it unique. So we think it's a new kind of Star Trek show, made by a lot of people who love all the old kinds of Star Trek shows.
Well, that's kind of a perfect kind of Star Trek show, isn't it? Exactly. Harry, did you watch Star Trek growing up in the UK?
My best friend, who I used to go around to his house after school every night, his dad was a massive Trekkie and had every single episode on VHS. It was like three episodes per VHS, and sort of 200 of them on a shelf.
Wow.
With a catalogue, and would sort of star them and rate them. So that was my...
So that would be you answering my question with a, yes, I did.
Yeah, I mean, I didn't, yes.
Do you have a favorite?
Oh, God. I would have to say the ones we're working on now.
Oh, perfect answer.
What is your friend's dad going to star these at? Like, that's what I'm interested in.
I don't know, but maybe his collection is worth something now on VHS, a starred sort of rated system. But he was called Alistair, and that's it.
Alex, you've talked a lot, and you did it earlier today. You talked a lot about the ethos of Trek and what that means to you, and sending messages. You talked as we on the Discovery Channel panel about, you know, the world and the message it sends. Picard is the philosopher captain in many ways, very different than William Shatner's Kirk, who was more of a cowboy in some ways, very different than other captains. For you, how does that message come to life with this show in the times we live in, which, let's be brutally honest, could really use some optimistic look at the future, in my opinion, here.
You know, I said it in the we talked this week, Domenic, and I think Picard represents the captain, that the ideal captain, not just as a philosopher, but also as a human being, who thinks first and foremost about the human spirit and its consequences over time, and the choices that he makes are not choices he makes in a vacuum. He is the leader we all want, and boy, do we need that now more than ever. So I think what we all really feel and what we really talk about, and again, it's impossible to distinguish the character of Picard from Patrick himself, because they really are in many ways one in a beautiful, beautiful way. And so Michael's not kidding. Like when Patrick says, "I will always be able to tell you what I will or wouldn't say," the prism that he's using is also every line that Picard says has to represent a philosophy and an ideal and an idealism. And yes, TNG reflected, I guess, a more innocent time. And it was always telling great stories, complicated stories, modern parables. But we live in a much, much more complicated and darker time now. And Trek at its best has always been a mirror that's reflected the world that we live in. So Picard, I think, in the best way, is the one who's still standing up for what matters. He's the one who's still standing up for the ideals that we believe in, Age has not changed his resolve. It's just changed the circumstances of his life. And this is being made, you have to understand, by people who love TNG. We're not seeking to reinvent it. We're not seeking to say ours is better or we're doing the dark version of TNG. None of that is true. We're not doing any of that. But Picard has to soul search, and to soul search, you need a dark night of the soul in order to come out the other side lighter and brighter. And in order to make the world brighter, he has to face that part of himself. And he's still fighting for all the things he would have fought for in TNG. But because the circumstances of his life have changed, he doesn't have the same resources. And so he has to dig even deeper into himself in order to get there. And I think that's why he remains such an aspirational and amazing captain, because we all want to believe that in the darkest of times, the best part of ourselves would emerge, and that is Jean-Luc Picard and Patrick.
Yes. Yes. I just, Alex, that was incredibly moving, and thank you so much. Issa and Santiago, give us a little bit of a sense, without any spoilers, about your characters and their relation to Jean-Luc. Without any spoilers. I know.
Tall order.
Yeah.
Well,
I know him.
My God. So I played Dodge, and she's a young woman entering a very new and exciting chapter of her life. Yet a horrible tragedy strikes in her life, and that is what sends her on a journey to find Picard, looking for answers and looking for help.
Santiago?
I play Cristóbal Chris Ríos, who is ex-Starfleet, and also someone with some inner demons, and something in his past has sort of created a hard shell around this man, and hence he is quite reluctant to help Picard when he meets him, and that's all I can say.
Well, you know, obviously we've had a lot of that's all I can say, and I've been trying to avoid spoilers, but I'm not going to... That's BS. Let's do it. Sir Patrick Stewart has a gift for you, ladies and gentlemen of Hall H. I think you're going to want to pay attention.
I have a small request to make. If you can hold your enthusiasm until the very end of the trailer, it means that you might pick up a little bit more than you did the first time. Then, when it's over, you can riot! So, cue trailer, second time. All right, good. Thank you. You excel yourselves. That was music to our ears. However, in the terms of music, we have three other guests we would like you to meet. First of all, from the original Next Generation, Jonathan Del Arco. And Mr. Brent Spiner. And finally, yes, here she is, Jeri. Well, I'm done.
Okay.
Unless there's more.
We're never done.
Okay.
Surprise!
Yeah!
Quarterback.
Wow. I had no idea I was in this.
Oh, come on, guys. Look who showed up. You can do a lot better than that.
Oh.
Well, I have to ask. I'll start, Jeri. I mean, the crowd went crazy the first time we saw you. How the hell did this happen?
To be honest, over a year ago, sitting at the Hollywood Bowl, I was with Johnny, actually, and one of the creators, who's a good friend of ours as well, and he, after about four glasses of champagne, decided that would be the time to bring it up. And so here's what I'm thinking. And I thought, okay, that could be fun, but I really never thought anything was going to come of it. And then I kept hearing it from other creators of the show over the course of the year, and it was mentioned again, and I was like, yeah, it's cool, but I still never really thought it was going to happen. And then, Captain, here we are. It's pretty surreal.
Pretty great. Jonathan?
I was also drunk at the Hollywood Bowl.
Alex, is there something you want to tell us about the Hollywood Bowl and Star Trek? There's a connection.
She has a box at the Hollywood Bowl, so we go. My experience was, we're buds, so the Borg share everything.
Collective,
it's
you know.
Collective, no matter what. That conversation began, and we were both like, is it going to happen?
No.
Is it going to happen? Cut to the realization that it was going to happen, yeah. And that I'd have to have a life mask, which is the basically poured cement onto your face. And I said to Jeri, I can't do the job. I can't do the life mask because I'm majorly claustrophobic. And
it's literally a cast of your head.
And she said, honey, take a pill and I'll drive you. And she stayed with me for 5 hours like a mama Borg. And made sure I was all right. It was 100% worth it because...
He was a rock star.
Because, we can't talk about the design of the makeup, but James McKinnon, who was the key head makeup artist and prosthetics in our show, just got nominated for an Emmy. I think he's here somewhere. I think so. Anyway, are you in here? Anyway. Yay! Emmy winner, Emmy nominee, people! We did it, and it happened, and I still didn't. And then I didn't believe it until I was actually on set, to be honest. And oh my God, getting to work with Patrick again—that's been that was worth the life mask.
Well, we all know there's someone else who we're very glad to see back with us.
I think it's you, Bella. I think it's you.
Brent, I mean, the crowd went crazy when they saw that you and Sir Patrick together. Please tell us how this came to be and what it's like.
Well, I first heard that there was going to be this Star Trek Picard. I called the producers and I said, do you have anybody for the role of Picard yet? And they hung up on me, and then, but then I spoke to Patrick, and he said, you know, there's a possibility. Would you think about coming on the show in some way, appearing on the show? And I said, I don't think I could do that. And he started crying, and I just couldn't take it. So, I spoke to the powers that be on this show. It's an incredible, incredible bunch of writers and producers. The possibility of standing next to Patrick on a set again was just more than I could say no to. And I had to consider the fans as well. To think that this was going to happen, and there was a possibility that I might be there. There was no way I could refuse that. Of course I had to be there. So, here we are.
Sir Patrick, what is it like for you to have these old friends on stage, on camera with you again, now Picard?
I'm sorry, would you ask that question again?
I said, what is it like to have these old friends back on camera with you again in Picard?
Well, you've got to get your laughing gear in place, that's for sure. because we have more fun, I think, than should really be allowed in a very expensive series.
Can I just say that having observed it, the joy on Patrick's face on the days when we've had returning cast members, and in particular one whose name came up earlier, but I just want to mention, is a part of Star Trek Picard, not only having directed two episodes, but it will be returning along with Marina Sirtis, and that is Jonathan Frakes. And seeing, when Frakes was directing, seeing Patrick and Jonathan together, it just, I would go to the set just so I could see the smiles on their faces and the fun. I mean, Jonathan Frakes brings joy and light wherever he goes anyway, but just it seemed to me, Patrick, like you were just so filled with joy.
What is extraordinary about this experience is that, yes, everything that Michael has said does apply when I come face to face with Brent, with Jeri, with Jonathan, and it will very soon be with Marina and Jonathan Frakes as well. But we have here, sitting between me and Brent, a new team, a new crew, if you like, in the sense of being a cast in this show. And I am astonished and grateful for the speed with which this has become a team, a cohesive unit working together. I thought it might take the whole of the first season, and we still have about 3 episodes to go, and we are already cemented together, and that makes me happy and proud.
Yes! Now, we are very happy and proud to be able to take questions from you guys. I see you. Where are you? You're over there? Wow, yes. Hello. How are you? Your name is?
Hi, my name is Jennifer.
Hey, Jennifer, and who's your question for?
My question is for all the cast and crew.
Oh, you get one. You got to choose one so everyone can ask a question.
Okay. First, it's an honor to have you here.
Yes.
And we thank you. My question really is directed at Mr. Stewart. What I'm wondering is, how have your children and grandchildren been influenced by your role as Jean-Luc Picard, by Star Trek in general?
How have I been influenced?
How have your children and grandchildren been influenced by your role?
Oh, well, they were a super influence because when the murmur of Star Trek The Next Generation came up, towards the end of 1986, I had to go to my children and say, what the heck is this? Because I was a stage actor and was only at home occasionally when they were very small. I would steal away from the theater after a matinee, rush home so that I could have a little bedtime with them before going back in and doing an evening performance. And often on a Saturday at about 6 o'clock, I saw them watching this thing on television with these guys in colored t-shirts. And that's all I knew about Star Trek. So they were the ones who first introduced me to Star Trek. And I'm so deliriously happy that now I have 4 grandchildren who have the same attitude to what we're doing. And Mason, my grandson, only this morning said, hey, I hear the trailer's gonna be released, we're gonna be able to see it. When can I see it? I wanna be the first to see it. And so that gave me great satisfaction.
Hello, sir.
Hello there. My question is for Sir Patrick Stewart.
I feel a trend is starting.
My question is, stepping back into this role, there's probably memories from filming the Next Generation series that have resurfaced. I'm wondering if there were any moments that stand out for you or characteristics that you're going to bring with you coming back to this role in this new series. Thank you.
Well, there was one, and then maybe we should ask Brent and Jonathan and Jeri. But when we were shooting the last episode of the series, oh, here it goes. Jonathan Frakes and I had a scene in the captain's ready room. And he said, "It's been an honor, Captain." And I was supposed to say, "No, the honor has all been mine." And I couldn't say it. The emotion of saying goodbye to those 7 years was so intense. We tried again and again and again to get it on camera, and it was almost impossible. And I found, as soon as we began talking in the writer's room, that powerful emotion came surging back, and it's still right here on this platform, and it's not going to go away.
We have time for two more questions, so sir?
My question is also for Patrick Stewart.
I have a feeling that trend is going that way, yes.
I just want to know what keeps you coming back to these iconic pop culture roles.
Well, he's really good at them. I'm just saying.
What other roles? What roles were they? I loved the X-Men series. I mean, you cannot have too many franchises in a career.
Oh my God, look at you look amazing. Look at this outfit, yes.
This is actually for Alex Kurtzman. You spoke
a little bit
about the importance of diversity in Star Trek. I was wondering how you intend to address the implications of this incredibly diverse crew on Discovery, their accomplishments and their actions being erased from the historical record.
That's a great question. While their actions have been erased from the historical record, the spirit of everything Trek lives on after them. And they're bringing that same thing into the future, a future that needs it very, very much. We're going to be actually leaning into that even more in season three. So we're not erasing what we've done. It's very important to us, I think, generally, that all Trek, as I said, carries a message. I had a very powerful experience with Dr. Mae Jemison, who was the first African American astronaut in space. And we were on a panel together in New York, about 2 or 3 years ago. And I just fell in love with her immediately. And I said, "Okay, why astronaut, why?" And she said, "Uhura. I saw Uhura when I was a kid."
Holy.
So I thought, oh my God, if we can inspire more Uhuras, then that's our job right now. And then someone else is gonna do it in 50 years, and then hopefully 50 more. So our commitment to that kind of diversity is not going anywhere anytime soon.
I would just say to you too, if your commitment to Star Trek isn't going anywhere soon, you can go visit the Star Trek booth on the convention floor. And there's also up on at the Michael J. Wolfe Fine Arts Gallery up the street here in the Gaslamp, there's the Jean-Luc Picard, the First Duty exhibit, where you'll see costumes and all sorts of things from both Next Gen and the new series. And with that, Hall H, please get on your hands for the cast and creators of Star Trek Picard and Kirk Patrick.